So today's session is slightly different because today we don't go over technical contents or research problems that some of us are working on. Today we are going over the classes that are being offered in our department or outside of our department. The reason why we have decided to organize this session was because in the past, some of the students often express their confusion or say frustrations about they don't know exactly what classes they want to take. As a graduate student, especially in the first few years, one of the important things that you have to do is taking classes. And of course, all our classes, informations are available in the course catalog. But at the same time, we can see that this is nothing more than like list of classes, and there are just so many classes that are available. So it can be disorienting to figure out exactly what might be suitable classes to take if your interest lies in a particular topic. So the faculty decided to organize a special CS201 session so that in the session, in each of the 8 fields that we have in our department, at least one faculty member kind of briefly go over what are the important backgrounds or important knowledge that you need to have if you want to develop a career in that particular field, and what are the classes that are very relevant that are being offered in our department or outside of the department. So today we have 8 presentations from each of the 8 fields that we have in the department, and in most cases a faculty member in working in that field will give a very high level overview of the field, like what are the important knowledge that you need and what are the classes that are being offered. So hopefully after listening to today's presentations, you will have a better ideas about how to plan for your study, the courses that you want to take while you're studying at UCLA, and how to construe your, let's say, proposal of fields or proposal of the studies, etc. So with that introduction, let me introduce the first speaker, Professor Glenn Ryman. And then he will talk about the field of architecture.
Hi, everybody. I think I have the right kind of shirt for this thing. Yeah, I lost my fuzzy thing. All right, cool. So I wanted to talk a little bit about architecture and give you kind of a brief overview of the classes. But first, let me follow what Dr. Cho was saying and talk maybe a little bit more about what the field has overall, what it would be like, what kind of knowledge you'd want to bring from that field after you graduate from here. So if you look at architecture as a whole, there's kind of this instruction set architecture level that kind of provides the border between hardware and software, right? So you've got the microarchitecture down here, and you've got sort of applications floating up here, operating systems, compilers, some of the low-level software that would interact with the architecture itself, right? And to some extent, this architecture builds on physical design. So we'll call it phys design. Things like not just constants in physics, like the speed of light, or how much low-k dielectric affects electrical conductance, but really how circuits are being built, what type of materials we're using. And if you look at what architects do, computer architecture, they often bridge between these different worlds. If you look at an architect who kind of focuses in on the applications and how they influence the architecture, they might study something like molecular dynamics and come up with a processor architecture that's designed specifically for that. Or they might look at a problem like graphics processing, design a GPU. It's an application-driven view of architecture, right? But it's also possible to look at it from the perspective of the physical design side. Somebody who is looking at what types of technologies will be available in the future. Can we have RF technology or optical technology for faster interconnect? Can we use different types of quantum physics principles for quantum computing? And all of that will drive how the architecture is designed, right? And then there are some people, I'm running out of different ways of drawing lines here, but there are some people who would then look at this whole thing as a holistic view and say, what types of applications are going to be in the future? What types of physical design elements are going to be there? And what type of architecture should I build? There's this chicken and egg problem with architecture where we don't have the compiler chain, we don't have the OS tools for the future, we have what will work on current generation machines. And if we really want to push the architecture and see what's going to come next, we have to kind of look ahead to those different elements. Okay, so we could sit here and talk about this all day, but my point of going into that was, while architecture, this traditional side of machine organization, development is certainly one important aspect. Really getting into bridging areas is also very crucial. Operating systems, compilers, circuit design, all those things can have a very important impact for an architect. That being said, here at UCLA, I was going to show a picture of all of us faculty in architecture, but I saved you the pain of that. So instead, really what I want to focus in on, there's really two types of faculty here at UCLA, one of which is sort of the traditional microarchitects, focusing in on, we have this silicon sandbox to play with, what kind of components we put in, and there are people who are sort of more in the application area. And they're looking at, well, given what we can do with computing, let's think about non-traditional compute type devices, embedded, maybe putting a compute device in your shoe to be able to determine how you're walking, which might help ambulatory patients in hospital settings. Or maybe adding extra security by using physical unclonable functions or other types of interesting things where they're really looking at more applied of instead of this traditional kind of microarchitecture area. So given those sort of two areas, I got these slides from our chair, our department chair, our field chair. So excuse me while I make sure that I'm aware of what I'm covering here. These first few different classes, 251A, 251B, are sort of the beginning intro graduate courses in computer architecture, the sort of traditional microarchitecture. These classes don't require anything beyond undergraduate architecture classes. And for our undergraduate architecture, we have 151B, which is kind of the beginning class and really only class in computer architecture. Then beyond that, we have arithmetic processors and algorithms, sort of taking beyond these sort of stepping stone classes. Even though it's not a formal requirement for those classes, it sort of goes beyond and focuses in on computation, especially arithmetic. 256A looks at scalable architectures and looks at, as we look at scaling up massive computing, lots of big data applications here, if we would need to have a number of different machines hooked together, how would we do that? Then we have these 259 classes, and these are classes where the topics kind of change with the times. I teach one on microprocessor design that focuses on recent topics that have been published in the top conferences in computer architecture. There's one that Professor Ursagovic teaches on approximate computing and how do we use non-precise computing to try to speed up computation or create things that are more power efficient. And then Dr. Kong is looking at big data applications in particular, and he likes to look at a whole holistic view of this compute area. He comes from a CAD background. He's bringing it towards architecture. We also do have other faculty in computer architecture who are teaching classes that are not in this 2.5x series. They are more in the application area. So you can look for Professor Sarafzadeh and Professor Podkonyak. But they are often not teaching classes within this particular set of ranges. Now, outside of this area, we recommend compilers, distributed computing, VLSI design, which could be from our EE friends, operating systems, and especially looking at application areas like big data, vision, mobile augmented reality, anything where there's a really difficult application to crunch and you can focus in on how to design the architecture for that. All right, so I think I may be out of time. So questions? That must mean I answered everything. All right, cool. Thank you.
And the next presentation is from AI. Professor Adnan Darwin.
Let me get my slides. Where do I stand? This is the up and down. Okay. All right. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'll give overview of the courses in artificial intelligence and machine learning. I'm going to start first by I'm going to scare you with this list of courses and numbers. I'm going to give you some insights into this in just a little bit. But let me just start by saying the list starts with this undergraduate course, actually, 161, which is the course we have on AI. It's important because I'm going to have a slide on it in a way because it kind of gives an overview of most of what happens later. And it's also a popular class for graduate students. They take it, actually. for the graduate courses that come after that, there's two groups. This group here, which has been around for a while, and students actually have a lot of background on these courses. So if you talk to your colleagues and so on, you get a lot of insights of what happens. But there's also three more courses that are being introduced. They will start next winter. And those I highlighted, and I'm going to have a slide just on these towards the end because they're new and very little information is available about them. We're just lucky that we had a number of new faculty in the area of machine learning that will be teaching these. And then I'll say something else about courses from outside later. So let me go to the next slide. So this is the undergraduate course we do on AI. It's quite, as I said, popular. It's an elective class. Graduate students usually tend to take it. It covers kind of four general topics. Knowledge representation and reasoning. This is where people learn how to represent information. It's a core subject in computer science all across, but it's one that AI have said a lot about. So here you study logical representations like propositional logic, first order logic. You study probabilistic representations like probabilistic graphical models. That's a major component. The other major component is this problem solving and search, where you learn how you solve problems by formulating them as combinatorial search problems. This is, again, a core subject in computer science. This is like your tool set for doing, for example, NP-complete problems, right? So whether you're doing AI or not, this stuff I tell people, it's kind of universally applicable. And then natural language is self-explained here. And then the last part is machine learning. So machine learning is an interesting subject because it's pretty broad and big, and some of the techniques or some of the things that are done in machine learning can be easily approached here given this background. So we do a little bit of machine learning. Some other topics in machine learning require kind of a different kind of training than this, so I'm going to comment a little bit more on that. So continuous optimization, linear algebra, it's not easy to squeeze in this course, so we don't do that here, but you'll do those at the graduate level. We currently do not have a course, undergraduate course in machine learning, but we're hoping now we're positioned to do that. So don't be surprised if, you know, the next year or so you'll see a course dedicated to machine learning, which covers many more than that. Okay, so why did I spend so much time on this particular course and slide? Because you can think of our graduate courses as really expanding on these different themes, right? So the course for the subject of knowledge representation and reasoning, there is basically, you can think of three classes that do that. 262A, which is learning and reasoning with Bayesian networks, is basically probabilistic knowledge representation and reasoning. 264A, which is, what is that? Automated reasoning, it's about logic. So that's where the focus becomes on logical representation and reasoning. Causality can be thought of as more on the subject. It's a bit specialized, taught by Professor Pearl. So I teach these two courses typically. Professor Pearl teaches that. This is not as oftenly, you know, offered now. Let me see, how am I going? Okay, yeah, so that's causality. Problem solving and search, that's the course taught by Professor Rich Korf, our undergraduate vice chair now. So that's 261A. There's a couple of courses on natural language. This is a little bit, this is natural language, this is more of maybe also here. And then you have machine learning. So machine learning, you have the dedicated course, which is, let me see, 260 machine learning algorithm. That's being offered now, actually, by Professor Amitul Walker. Some of you probably are taking that already. And 262A, which is reasoning, learning and reasoning with Bayesian networks, it's kind of split between here and there. And these are the three new courses that I told you about that are coming up. So I just want to have one more. Keep going in the wrong direction here. Okay. The one more slide to tie this also to some courses outside, and then the last slide on the new courses. This is one way to relate. So three of these subjects actually interact in a very interesting way. So the problem solving and search, which I told you kind of your tool set for solving NP-hard or NP-complete problems, where you take problems, formulate them as combinatorial search and use algorithms like A-star and heuristic search to search these spaces that have millions and billions of candidates, core to everything in a sense. A lot of the reasoning algorithms that are done here are based on search. Some of the techniques for machine learning, like learning the structures of Bayesian networks or Markov networks, are actually based on search as well. So this is kind of a core computational tool. In knowledge representation and reasoning, you study probabilistic and logical representation, modeling and inference, which are key also to machine learning, right? Most of machine learning today is about probabilistic representations. If you go to some of the more advanced topics that I'm going to mention in the next slide, you'll also need first-order logical representations and so on. The one thing that's missing here, and I hope I had a fourth circle, is the other set of math or background that you need for machine learning, which is continuous optimization, linear algebra, and so on. So actually, there's a nice sequence on that in EE. Professor Levin Vandenberg actually have a sequence on this, and some of our students actually do the whole thing. It gives them very solid background. So you can think there is one more circle here to give you the background that's needed for machine learning beyond these like core CS, and the others are more math and so on. Okay, so I'm gonna go to the last slide now. So these are the three courses that are being introduced. They're new, people know very little about them, and I asked the corresponding faculty to give me experts. I paraphrased a little bit on the subject. So these are in the order in which we hope that they will be offered. So this is actually planned for winter, advanced topics in machine learning, Feisha, and topics that are not in textbooks, right? Frontier, state of the art, deep learning architectures, related topics, pattern recognition, graphical models, well, some background. I think it was just listed recently, so you can see what kind of courses you need familiarity with to take that. The following one in the spring by Amit Walker, Scalable Machine Learning, Underlying Statistical and Algorithmic Principles Required to Develop Scalable Real-World Machine Learning Pipelines, An Integrated View of Data Processing, Highlighting Various Components of These Pipelines, Data Analysis, Feature Extraction, Supervised Learning, and Model Evaluation. So it's kind of more on the system side of machine learning. And the last one, Statistical Relational Learning, Guy Van de Broek. So hopefully that will be the fall. Statistical Representations of Relational Data, including Markov Logic, Probabilistic Databases, and various learning algorithms for inference, you know, parameter and structure estimation. So once you actually do this, this is actually now, it's another area of machine learning where you start doing first order probabilistic representation. And once you're in that business, you get into probabilistic databases and basically probabilistic programming as well. So that will be covered as well. So it's a very nice span of topics that we have lined up for the future on this. One last comment before I close. There's another set of courses that are relevant to machine learning. And these are offered by STAT, cross-listed in CS by Professor Alan Yule and Sun-Chun Ju. This is one example of them, machine learning, but they're special in a particular way. They tend to be focused on vision applications. I think Professor Sawato will talk about vision later, and the kind of inference algorithms they use are complementary to what's discussed in the other courses. They're more focused on sampling. So if you're interested in those kind of subjects, you're gonna get a nice exposure from these set of courses. There's about three of them as well, in addition to the ones in EE that I've mentioned. So these would be also relevant. That's basically it. So if you have any questions, happy to answer them. Yes? So yes, so actually, this one is in the winter, available, that will be listed this winter. This is a spring. And this is hopefully the fall, a year from now. They all have this 269, just for people to explain. 269 or 2x9 is the selected topics. When people introduce new courses, they start with this label as they kind of fix things, and then they become like, you know, other kind of labels, and they get fixed numbers. But these are all like selected topics because they're just being introduced. So in other areas, you're gonna see like 259, 249, 239, they're all in the same category of selected topics. Any other questions? And let me just, one last remark. It looks like there's a lot of dependencies between these things, but actually we try, all of us, to make our courses self-contained. We don't want you to like really take a long path to get to a course, right? But the best way to really know about prerequisites and so on is to talk to the individual faculty and let them know about your background. But we try very hard to make it possible for you to get to a course directly instead of just like walking through a long sequence. Right? All right, thank you. Oh, you need this. I don't keep it.
Thank you. So the next speaker is Professor Stefano Sawato, and he will talk about visions and computer graphics.
So the mic is for the
recording.
Or you even screwed it in. All right, you unscrewed it. So how many of you are masters here? Well, let's do the one minus. How many of you are PhD students? Minority. Okay. All right. So let me at the outset say that my interpretation of my reading of the charter for today is not to describe the content of the courses or the fields. Presumably, you know something about the fields and the content of the courses you can get from the register, but it's to give you a sense of what other courses, which are not the ones that we offer in CS, are useful if you want to be either a user of vision or graphics or a maker of vision or graphics. A user means somebody who is informed and capable of using techniques that are developed in the field, but may or may not develop novel ones. Whereas a maker is one who is actually actively developing techniques in the area. So I apologize for the brevity. Tomorrow is the deadline for CVPR, which is the largest conference for us. And so this is going to take 10 minutes. All right. So first, let me put forward the description that a colleague of mine has asked me to present for computer graphics. For some reason that is mostly historical, graphics and vision are lumped together. They are related to each other in the same way in which black and white are. So graphics is the art of generating images, okay, using, in particular computer graphics, using computational techniques. So the outcome, the output, is an image. Okay, there is no right or wrong image. There may be images that are more or less photorealistic, more or less pretty, but basically the name of the game is to generate the output you want to generate, whether it's photorealistic or not, and do it in a way which is computationally efficient, whether or not that way mimics the way in which physically images are generated through light and scattering and so on and so forth. Okay, so there's no falsifiability, there's no wrong images, but it's developing computational tool at the service of creativity and art and so on and so forth. So it still helps to know math, geometry, linear algebra, so I think you will see patterns among all the people that are describing their courses, that the best investment you can make for your long-term future is to take as many math courses as you can. And so the goal here is to point you in the right direction for what's relevant for vision and graphics. If you are here, presumably, who doesn't know how to program in C++? Okay. All right, so creativity and appreciation for art, science and engineering. And so the field of computer graphics is divided into three areas. One is rendering, which is the process of simulating the photometry of the world. Modeling, which is the process of simulating the geometry of the world, and animation, which is the process of simulating the dynamics of the world. Okay? So in rendering, you do things that look pretty. In modeling, you do things that have shapes. And in animation, you do things that move. More recently, people have, I don't know if this counts as graphics, but human-computer interaction is a veritable academic discipline. There are programs in HCI. And there, things are a little bit messier because you're essentially looking for ways of interfacing with humans. And so you need to know a little bit about humans, what they expect, how they react, what they want. So we have courses in the basics, undergraduate courses, the 174 series that has, roughly speaking, in theory, roughly speaking, modeling, rendering, and animation. In practice, A has a little bit of everything. B has a slightly more recent version of modeling or a subset of, sorry, of rendering. So traditionally, rendering are things like ray tracing, where you generate or simulate images out of nothing. Starting the mid-90s, people started looking at ways of simulating or synthesizing new images given actual images that somebody has taken. That's called image-based modeling and rendering. And that relates also to computational photography and to a lesser extent vision. And so that's 174B, and 174C is animation. Okay. There are graduate level equivalent. For instance, 274C and 174C are related. I actually don't know if they're taught concurrently. At some point, they used to be. And then also in the terms of simulation of animation, there is also artificial life and 75, 70, 69. As Adnan says, the 2X9 are basically special topics courses, typically seminars or collaborative projects. In the middle, there are this CS188. Honestly, I don't know much about it. I'm not sure what it means that there are four courses with the same number but different title. Okay, so it's like 2X9, but for undergrads. Okay. All right, so dependencies. All right, so 174 is basically the zeroing course, where you get the basics, and everything else depends on that. I don't know what's done in visual modeling. Not sure why it needs 174B, but there it is. There are other courses. I cannot read from there. Other courses in different departments you can take. So if you don't know linear algebra, you will not get very far. Okay? And knowing linear algebra does not mean having passed the course, nor having taken an A in course. I've had people in my courses who got A+ in linear algebra and knew nothing about it. Okay? So that would be a good investment, especially if you've taken it in high school and forgotten it because, oh God, it's been 5 years since I saw that stuff. Okay. There's also a course in mathematics and computer graphics. This used to be called scientific computing. Typically, you deal with meshes and discrete numerical implementations of partial differential equations and deformable models and so on and so forth. There's also a course, 270A, that Joy Terran teaches, which also deals with basically the more sophisticated aspects of modeling and animation, for instance, for fluids, smoke, water, and so on and so forth, the ones you see in movies. And 272A, continuous mechanics. There's also courses in arts, if you're interested in game design. All right, so that's graphics. So vision is the art of generating images. And vision is the science of using images to say something about the scene. Why do I say it's a science? Because there is a falsifiability mechanism. If I want to say something about the scene, whether it's geometric, shape of objects, photometric, appearance, material, or dynamics, motion, I can go into the scene and verify whether the answer I got was right or wrong. Okay? And so falsifiability is the hallmark of a scientific process, and so there is such a process in vision. Vision has ramification in many areas, and so what I've done here is I've listed courses that are offered in vision, and in red, I've listed courses that everyone who wants to be a user of vision, meaning somebody who wants to later on at some point become an expert user of techniques that he or she has not developed, but knows how to use them, will have to have taken, or will have to understand. Okay, obviously we don't expect that anybody will take all of these courses. Okay. The ones in black are courses that anybody who is willing to be a maker of vision, to develop new techniques, would have to have exposure to, okay, in order to be able to develop expertise in a specific aspect of it. So I'll go quickly through it. So first, what's in CS? So 268 is sort of the zero leveling graduate course for visual geometry, okay, multiple view geometry, reconstruction, three-dimensional scenes from images, and so on and so forth. CS269 is an advanced seminar course on visual recognition, being able to name objects and their relations from images. Okay. These are the topics about which you read in newspapers these days. Okay. It helps to be versed in algorithms, so most of my students do take algorithms course. It helps to be users of machine learning techniques. So as Adnan said, there are new courses that focus on algorithms specifically for machine learning. And so CS276 is sort of an older, more like pattern recognition course where you learn about classifiers, VM, basic decision theory, very, very basic information theory. CS266 is statistical modeling and learning vision and image science. It's the course that Song Chun-Ju teaches. And it's basically a statistical approach to visual modeling. Why is it not in red? Because it's a course that if you want to be a vision maker, you want to be exposed to that way of thinking. But other courses, let's say the STAT 200 AMB, which are the zeroing level graduate courses in statistics, you will have no choice. You will have to know that stuff. Okay. So hopefully most of you will have taken something akin to STAT 200 AMB. If not, that would be a good investment of your time. STAT 238 is a course that Alan Yule used to teach. I don't know if it's been offered anymore, but it's basically a statistical approach to vision that has also had some use in neuroscience to explain human perception. Okay, so that's CS and STAT. There are many formative courses in math that you might want to take, depending on what level of detail you want to get into. So Math 120, kind of basic Docarmo, differential geometry of curves and surfaces, very useful. Fairly elementary stuff. You learn about tangent planes, curvatures, and so on and so forth. The grad level version of that, which is in red, which is 225A and 226A, is the more abstract version of it, where instead of talking about surfaces, you're talking about manifolds and varieties. And so differential geometry and topology, that's something that typically most of my students take. Math 273, new course introduced by Wotao Yin on convex and convex optimization, very, very useful stuff. Depending on some areas of vision, you might want to know about numerical integration of PDE and solution variational optimization problems. So for that, you take 251A and 266 and 269 and 270 that was already mentioned before. On the optimization, Adnan already said, so Wotao Yin teaches a course which is focused on proving convergence rate and more sort of at the abstract level. A very concrete course that I think every student in computer science who wants to do anything related to machine learning, computer vision, robotics, graphics should have taken would be the trilogy of courses that Lieven van den Berge teaches. A is linear programming. Most of you have seen it, so most of my students don't take it. But B and C, which are convex optimization and large scale optimization, are in the toolbox, should be in the toolbox of anyone who wants to dabble in this course, in these topics. Okay? Very, very useful. Matrix analysis is sort of the machinery of which convex optimization is built, so numerical linear algebra, and that's a course taught by Alan Laub. It's a little bit low level, so if you don't want to be the world expert in this stuff, maybe you can skip it, but if you do want to develop solvers for a specific problem, that's very useful. 211A is an old-fashioned image processing course in the way it was taught in the 80s. So I don't think any of my students take it. Detection estimation theory teaches very basic concepts that are also taught in 276, so pattern recognition, basic decision theory, and regression. Information theory is something that I believe every computer science student should take. Unfortunately, the way it's taught is taught by using communication people, so they put a lot of emphasis on channel coding and things like that, which is not that relevant to CS. But the core ideas are very, very important, and I would encourage everyone to take it. Then there are some fringe courses from neurology, from neuroscience, neuroanatomy, from psychology that have to do with the fact that in vision, we have a problem that mathematically you can prove cannot be solved, and yet we have existence proof in the form of the human visual system that does something. Now keep in mind, all of you, whether you're doing AI or software engineering or bioinformatics, your brain is about the size of your two hands, and half of it does vision, okay? So that's the one bit you need to know from your anatomy. If you're interested in ramification of vision towards embodiment, then there are new courses in robotics. There are two new faculty members in mechanical engineering that do that. And if you want to be fancy about your statistical methods, you want to take statistical mechanics and learn about spin glasses and that kind of stuff that informs some neural network. I think I'll leave it at that. And unless there's any quick question, I think that's all I had to say. Yep. You're talking about 276, which is the... Yes, so 174 B and C are not regularly offered. They're offered in years that are divisible by 67. So I don't know the rule, actually, by which they're offered. But it's at least every other year, certainly not yearly, if not... But I don't know, I don't have an answer to that.
So the next speaker Hello, music professor Yu Yong Kim, and she will talk about programming languages and software business.
Okay. So, So I would like to give an overview about the graduate courses in programming languages and software engineering, like software systems area. And one of the most misconceptions about this field is that people think that at a graduate level that, oh, I want to be a good software engineer, I want to have a more development experiences so that I want to take software engineering class. Or people think that, oh, you know, I know Java and C++, but I don't know ML, or I don't know Scala, I don't know Ruby and Rails, so I want to learn new, you know, programming languages, and therefore I want to take classes in this area. I think that's good motivation, but the courses actually focuses on, or the field focuses on, how to be more systematic in designing, testing, and, you know, designing, testing, and validating software, as well as how to actually construct a program, or how to reason about program semantics, or how to design a programming languages better so that we can help developers not to create bugs and then make more safe and correct software systems as they develop. So these are the core faculties. Paul Egger, he's a lecturer who teaches a like broad, like, you know, range of a software systems course. My name is Mi Ryung Kim. I do research in software engineering, so I teach undergraduate and graduate software engineering class. Professor Jens Passberg teaches classes in compilers and static analysis. And Professor Todd Milstein teaches classes in programming languages design, also on like how to prototype programming languages. And Professor Ryer teaches classes in security. So these are sort of overview about the graduate courses, and our area, the prefix is 2-3. So all the classes are like starting with the 2-3. So I'm going to have a later slides on each courses. Some of the courses actually hasn't been offered for a while, and you can kind of notice that, you know, the main faculty who teaches a graduate class is me, like Kim, Palsberg, and Milstein. And then we teach graduate courses, one the regular class and one special topics class, so two graduate classes a year. So I teach software engineering. Professor Milstein teaches types and programming languages, which is a sort of an intro course in programming languages area. Professor Palsberg teaches a static program analysis course, which is about how to reason about, you know, program. By the way, does people know what static analysis mean? Covariate? Yeah, covariate is a static analysis tool. But static, I don't assume you need to know. Static analysis means like reasoning about program behavior without running a program. So it's basically taking program as an input and reason about what program could do for vast amount of or infinite space of input that could be used for that program. So it's a reasoning about program semantics in a statically without running a program. Then Professor Milstein recently created two sequence courses on prototyping programming languages and programming language design lab. So this is a case where if you want to design your own programming language, what do I need to do, right? Like how can I design or prototype new language? And there is a class offered by Professor Ryer on computer security. So as I said, you know, graduate level software, in undergraduate level software engineering, I teach techniques so that students can become, in some sense, better engineers and better software engineers and developers. At the graduate level, what we teach is mostly automated techniques that reason about program semantics, that automatically test software, that design software automatically and synthesize or generate the code. How do we automatically transform software or refactor software system? How do we learn or infer precondition and postconditions automatically from program traces, like a runtime behavior, or program, you know, static program, or, so some of these, or how do we find bugs automatically? And here's what I want to say. Why do you want to take this class? It's because by learning how automated tools work internally, to find bugs automatically and to test software automatically, in some sense, you can indirectly learn how to be systematic in designing, testing, and validating, and transforming software. Types and programming language is a class that Professor Milstein teaches, and this class is really about reasoning about semantics of software. So suppose that you declare, like, multiplicator operator. What does it mean by really doing multiplication? What is a condition before, and what is a condition program state after? What is the formalism sort of behind programming language design, which goes back to lambda calculus? And whether the type that you use is a sound. What is a type here really means is that types are, in some sense, restriction on what you can write as you write program. So if it doesn't type check by compiler, basically a compiler is saying that your program is not good enough, so it's not runnable, or I'm not going to let you run it. So what it really does is kind of safeguarding like what kinds of like references you can make, as well as what kind of inheritance or subtyping you can do. And in some sense, you are learning this formalism in this class. Let me tell you what kind of students love this class. The people who love symbols, like first order logic, being able to write inductive proof, right? That's all the basis behind succeeding in this class. Like, so being able to deal with this mathematics. Most of the math depends on actually logical math or symbolic reasoning. The class that Professor Palsberg teaches in static analysis is on like optimization and bug finding. So what this class does is that now you're thinking about program in terms of just lines of a code, but in static analysis class, we think about program in terms of various types of internal program representation, like control flow graph, program dependence graph, and abstract syntax tree. And we are, in some sense, reasoning with respect to this intermediate program representation level. What are the analysis about? It's analyzing, can I subtype this one? Given a program point, what kinds of a variable could potentially influence this? And given the assignment or value changes, what are the program, other parts of a program that can be affected by this? And there are many different types of analysis, because analysis could depend on the degree of a difficulty you want to have. So for example, context-sensitive or insensitive analysis, what it means is that if I know where I'm called from, I'm analyzing a method, but do I have to consider which context the caller has called me from? So, in some sense, these analysis is adding more level of a complexity to reason about program semantics. Okay, so now, what kind of students do well in this class? The ones who can easily like think about graphical representation of a program, think about how value could flow from one to another, like can reason about graph reachability, think about the algorithms. So the student who has a strong like background, algorithms background, usually like these classes and generally do well too. Then we teach class, so those three are sort of the main graduate classes. If you want to do research in compilers or PL, I recommend taking Palsberg and Milstein's class. If you want to do research in software engineering, I recommend taking mine. So 239 are special topics class, and it's a different topics every time. It's research focused, and people come up with a class that resonates with their current theme. So for example, in the next quarter, I'm teaching class on data science and software engineering. It's partially inspired by how I saw software engineers now really need a, analysis of a big data skills to succeed in software industry. Places like a Microsoft are hiring, people with the statistics and machine learning background, because now what they're doing is they automatically instrument the software to capture software behavior, and then analyze those behavior to have a confidence about software quality. So in addition to doing testing, which they already do, they're doing more large scale data analysis to have a confidence about software. So what I teach in this class is basically how do you automatically instrument software systems so that you can capture behavior in runtime? How to analyze this data using statistics, machine learning, and AI, some like usage of existing techniques? And then, you know, how do we also build this large-scale data pipeline where you can engineer, analyze this software artifacts data? Professor Parsberg also taught the class on parallel programming languages in 239. I believe it was a few years ago. So he's on sabbatical this year, but he may offer it again when he comes back. Okay. So if you would like to do, let's say, master's or thesis or research in this area, if you want to do research in programming languages, 231 and 232 are the background you really need to have to do research in this area. If you want to do software engineering, then you need a background in 230. Programming languages and software engineering are very neighboring field. So, you know, the foundations of reasoning about program semantics in PL is useful for designing these automated analysis tools and testing tools and verification tools. The applications in software engineering often inform the design decisions about how to design programming languages. So they are very neighboring field. We don't actually really have a sequence that we recommend. These courses, you can take it independent of one another, except this is a sequence course that Professor Milstein created recently on prototyping programming language design. Okay, so I created some cheat sheet for you. So yellow is undergraduate classes. Green is a graduate. If you can already see, 130 is a prerequisite for 230, sort of, in terms of knowledge. 131, undergraduate PL, is necessary for sort of catching up with the 231 PL. 132 compiler kind of becomes a graduate class 232. Professor Parsberg is on sabbatical 2016, so he probably will teach 2017. If you want to take 237B, since there's a prerequisite relationship, you should take it in winter. I'm offering this data science class in winter and regular software engineering graduate class in the spring. And these yellow classes are, probably undergraduate classes for 130, 132, 131. They're offered twice each year, usually. Okay, so just to summarize, software engineering assumes like background knowledge and familiarity with all programming and discrete mathematics. The special topics class, you may need some background in statistics, AI, and data mining at the undergraduate level. Static analysis requires some knowledge in undergraduate PL and compiler, and types are about formalism in programming languages and rules and proof. And generally in this field, the students who have a strong background, algorithm, discrete mathematics, logic, graph readability, and symbolic reasoning, these are useful skills to have in this field. Questions? Thank you. So static analysis class is, the goal is optimization. So given a program, how do we optimize, let's say remove dead code or unnecessary code or make it faster, right, run faster. Or the goal is also like bug finding, right? Like how do we find buggy code automatically, right? So it's a little bit different in the sense that we are accepting the languages already exist and we're trying to create a better compiled like binary given the source simple language. The prototyping programming languages meaning like I want to create my own language, right? Like some dialect of a JavaScript, right? Then what should I think about? That's what the course focuses. Yeah.
So it's like a step before compilers.
Step before, you could think of it as step after two. Yeah, so.
Oh, yes.
I'm having some. Okay, hello. I'm having some. There we go. Okay.
On any given day, millions of us are going.
Oh, he's told. I heard that I could play a video, so I'm gonna play a video. Okay.
About our daily lives, unaware of tiny ticking time bombs right inside our own DNA. Alzheimer's, cancer, stroke. Diabetes.
Very positive message, right?
Genetic variations and are thus inherited. But to what extent and how can scientists use genetic modeling to better predict risk factors for a given individual and help further personalize health care? Join us as we head to the University of California, Los Angeles to speak with Eleazar Eskin from the Department of Computer Science and Human Genetics. In the last 10 years, scientists have developed technologies that can measure DNA very effectively. And using these technologies, they were able to collect DNA from thousands of individuals. For example, if they're interested in understanding what genetic variants are involved in diabetes, they would collect 1,000 individuals with diabetes and 1,000 individuals without diabetes. And what they would do is they would look at the genetic variation, just measure the DNA at every position in these individuals' genomes, and compare to see if there's any genetic variants that are more common among the diabetics versus the non-diabetics. This technique is called the genome-wide association study, and really struck going in 2007. Unfortunately, the link between genetic markers and disease is not at all as straightforward as one would like. First of all, there's not just one single gene that is responsible for a certain disease, or even a physical trait, as simple as height. So far, scientists have discovered hundreds of genes that are involved in determining the height of an individual. But even when taking all of the genes currently known to be linked to a certain trait into consideration, there is still a huge gap between known and predicted heritability. This gap is known as missing heritability.
Even when they added up all of those variants together, they fell far short of what they expected to find. You see, decades ago, geneticists used twins to quantify how much information is predictive of disease risk. There are two kinds of twins, and the idea is that if you take how correlated a disease or a trait is among those two kinds of twins, you could quantify how much information there is in the genetic variation that predicts the disease. And based on these estimates that they've had for decades, when they added up all of the genetic variation that contributes to traits from GWASs, it fell far short of what they expected. And this is what they refer to as missing heritability.
What exactly accounts for the missing heritability and how to improve current computing models is research material for the future. Current studies suggest that the more variants are included in the analysis, the better the models perform, which opens up great challenges and opportunities for computer scientists.
Around 2010, a group from Australia used a different technique called mixed models. And what they did is they tried to estimate the contribution of all the variants in the genome to try to explain the heritability. And what they found using this technique, they could account for about half of the known heritability of these traits, which is a substantial increase over the 5% that was discovered in genome-wide association studies at the time.
Find out more in the review article, Discovering Genes Involved in Disease and a Mystery of Missing Heritability, in the October 2015 issue of Communications of the ACM.
Okay, so, yeah, kind of funny, right? Okay, so that was, I wanted to give an overview to our area because I think that, you know, when people think of what is bioinformatics? Okay, I don't know why it's doing that. What is bioinformatics? It's people don't know, but
actually I wrote this video is about this review article, which I think gives a summary of at least my area of bioinformatics, kind of targeted towards a computer scientist. And I just want to say a few words. So this is a huge field. Bioinformatics, computational biology is really, you know, the computational problems in biology. And in biology at UCLA, there's something like, there's literally thousands of faculty in biology here. What's done in the department is actually covers a very broad range of fields. So I work in an area called computational genetics, but there are other faculty, and I'll talk a little bit about what they do in a bit. So, you know, things really have taken off in this field in the last, let's say, 10 years. You know, the Human Genome Project was about 15 years ago. And so there's actually a lot of, we're going to kind of skip ahead. Anyways, one of the things, that big thing, is that there's this sequencing revolution for measuring DNA. So this is actually showing the cost of collecting sequence information over time. So this is time here, you know, the years. And this is just goes to 2010. And you see this dark line is the cost of collecting 1 million positions of DNA. The human genome is 3 billion, just to give you an idea. So the actual cost of the Human Genome Project to collect one individual was something like $1 billion. Today, it's like $1,000 or less. If you look at the other line, that's Moore's Law, just to give you a comparison. So the actual, you know, if you're spending the same amount of money on collecting genetic information and buying more computers, that your computing power is the data is increasing exponentially compared to your computing power. So there's a lot of opportunities. So this is the faculty that are involved in CompBio. So there's three kind of, there's many of us. There's myself, I work in genetics, kind of like related to the video. There's a new faculty coming, Sriram. He'll be arriving in the winter. He also works in kind of a little bit later. You might have heard about, they found all these Neanderthals are related to humans. Did anyone hear about that? No. Anyways, well, he was the one that discovered that. He does a lot of interesting things. Joe DiStefano works in an area called systems biology, looking how basically interactions of biological, particularly in cancers. He works a lot on cancers. He teaches some classes, and I'll go over the class in a second. Jason Ernst is another faculty. He's actually primarily in the medical school. He also teaches in our department. He looks at again, in bioinformatics, trying to predict the function, how various, the different parts of the DNA, what it does, using computational techniques. Wei Wang also works in kind of database group, but she also has a substantial activity in CompBio. And Chris Lee, he's a faculty in chemistry, so I'm going to talk about him when I talk about the classes. So we have now four kind of core classes in graduate classes in the department. I teach either one or two of them. There's the first one is Introduction to Bioinformatics. It's actually in fall. In winter, I teach Algorithms in Bioinformatics. That's in winter. Then there's Computational Genetics So the second one should be Algorithms in Bioinformatics, and 224 is called Computational Genetics. I mistyped it. And then Computational Systems Biology, I think it's taught by Joe DiStefano. So each of these courses, they don't depend on each other. You can take them in any order. And also, they don't require any biology background, so they're actually geared really towards students like you. Anything in biology will teach you. There's also another set of courses taught every quarter, which are kind of current topics in bioinformatics. That's number 229. And those also don't take any prerequisites. There, it's different every time. You can actually take more than one of them. Okay, so that's all. If anyone has any questions, feel free to send me an email. Thanks.
Okay. The next speaker is myself. So I will briefly go over the courses that is offered in information data management field. So before I talk about the courses, let me briefly go over a very high-level overview of what this field is about and what are the career possibilities. If you major in this particular field, what are the kinds of the jobs that you will get? Because that one, the kinds of career possibility, career path actually dictates on what kind of skills you need. Depending on the particular kinds of career path, you may need completely different skill sets. So I want to briefly go over that. So at a very high level, information data management is all about data. How can we store data? How can you collect the data? How can you process the data? How can you transfer the data? How can you analyze data? How can you understand the data, right? So that is where everything started from. And as computers, as we use computers for more and more systems and applications, we realize that in many cases, really the data is something very essential for almost everything, right? So many of the companies do require storing their customer data or their particular scientific data, what kind of data it is. So a lot of businesses now need somebody who is understanding, who understands how to store and process the data and how to analyze them. So at a high level, there are, I would say, two classes of people who are kind of working in this area. The first class of the people is the engineers who understands how to process and store large quantities of data so that other people who needs to access that data, who needs to retrieve the data later on, is able to do that. So I call them, those are data systems engineers. And they are essentially, what they are doing is they are doing data plumbing. They collect the data, they store the data, and whenever people need that data, they essentially provide the data. And that is not a straightforward task, because there has been a lot of work that has been done, a lot of interesting data structures, a lot of interesting data algorithms that people developed. So one set of classes are essentially focusing on that aspect. What are the things that you need to know in order to build a system that is able to process large quantities of data? And the second class of people that are related to this data, information and data management is the data analyst. Now, they assume that the overall infrastructure is already there. But now their goal is, given all this large quantity of data that has been collected, how can we analyze them so that we can do something interesting about it? How can we learn about the businesses? How can we learn about the users that that are using our system so that we can improve our application, so that we can build interesting applications, right? So those are the data scientists. And the third class of the people are really not about the data, but they are trying to build some interesting applications. And in order to build any interesting applications, they need to access the data, so they are using existing infrastructures to build their applications. So if you're majoring in information and data management, those are kinds of the possible career path. And what is interesting about these different kind of career path is that if you want to major, if you want to develop your career as a data systems engineer, then essentially what you need is you need a very solid computer science and computer engineering background, in the sense that you need to develop software, you need to build a system, overall system architecture, so that all this plumbing can be done efficiently using existing infrastructure. So for those, you have to know about computer systems architecture. And recently, because of the massive amount of data that are stored over distributed systems, you also need to know things about parallel and distributed systems or distributed data systems. And because your job is building real systems, you also have to know overall kind of processes for programming and software development. And also you need to know the exact tools that people are using in the industry. So the popular examples are like RDBMS or relational data management systems and Hadoop, et cetera. Okay? So that is the data systems engineering. In case of data scientists, what they are doing is once you have this large quantity of data that you have collected, they're just running some algorithm, interesting data analysis algorithm on top of it so that we can extract some interesting information or knowledge from it. And for that, you definitely need a very strong background in mathematics, because a lot of things, all these modelings that we are doing is based on this mathematical modeling. So like things like linear algebra is very important, and some knowledge about probability and statistics is also very important. And many of these algorithms are essentially based on these optimization algorithms. So learning about this optimization theory is also very important. And of course, for data analysis, there are a lot of interesting data structures and algorithms that we developed in order to do them, so you have to learn about them. And also, eventually, you will have to use some tools in order to run those algorithms, so you have to learn about all these data analytic tools like MATLAB, Python, and R, etc. Okay, so those are the kind of the core background knowledge that you have to develop, that you have to learn if you want to build your career in this particular discipline. So in terms of the classes that our department offers, so there are two undergraduate level fundamental classes that everyone has to take, whether you are in this or that career path. If you want to be in information data management, these are the two classes that you will either have taken in your undergraduate curriculum. If not, then you have to take them here. The first one is database systems. So this is being offered by three of us. So every quarter we have one class of CS143. And there, essentially what we teach you relational database systems, right? So relational database system is one of the most popular data management systems that almost all companies use. So we'll teach about that. But in addition, we also, while we are teaching it, we tell you the basic data structures that are being used for it and basic algorithms that are being used for it, so that even if later, if you're not using relational database systems, but different kinds of database systems, the knowledge about those fundamental data structures and algorithms can be useful for different kinds of systems as well. So that is database systems. The second class is CS145, which is data mining. There, the core, the basic topics of the data mining is, now we have collected this old data, then what are the basic algorithms, basic analytic tools that you can use on top of it so that we can extract some interesting patterns or interesting knowledge from it. Okay, so that is undergraduate level data mining classes. In terms of graduate level courses, so CS240 series, like CS240A and CS240B, we can think about that as an extension of CS143 in the sense that now you learned about these basic relational database systems, but there are a lot of advanced things that you want to do, like more active database systems or temporal database systems or object relational database systems and like stream database systems. So what are the important issues that are related to it? What are the basic algorithms and what are the systems that you can use? So those are the CS240A and 240B classes. In terms of CS246, which is offered by me, so there is this kind of large quantity of data that are not structured at all, that is essentially textual data, right? And in case of textual data, there are different kind of tools and algorithms that people developed, like how to build a good web search engine, right? How can you cluster them, etc. So in CS143, the primary focus is, given the textual data, what are the things that it can do on top of it so that we can manage them efficiently and we can access them more efficiently? So that is the topic of CS246. And the CS249 series is all being offered by a number of different faculty members. So let me briefly go over each of them. So the first CS249, basic data science, is about, so in that class, Professor Parker is teaching you some of the basic tools that you can actually use, the real tools that you can use to explore the data. In any case, for any data scientist, in order to, before they actually build the real models, etc., first they want to get a good sense of what the data is like. They want to explore the data and run very simple analysis to kind of have some insights about that data. So in the basic data science class, Professor Parker is introducing you some of these very simple basic models to analyze the data and some of the existing tools that you can use so that you can explore and visualize the data as the first level analysis of the data. Okay, so that is basic data science. In CS249, big data analytics, you can think about it as an extension of CS145, so more advanced algorithms of data mining and how we can somehow scale it to much larger data set. Okay, so that is CS249. And the last big data systems is about these cloud systems. So traditionally, when people develop database systems, they assume that this is really critical data that we don't want to lose at all, like banking data or military data. Those are very important. So we are willing to pay whatever cost to preserve and not lose the data at all. But recently, as these internet applications like Facebook, these kinds of things become more popular, like Google, there, we don't really care about losing the data too much, right? So like if you use one Facebook update, how important is it if you lose that? So people are not willing to pay that much. So these Facebook, like these companies cannot use traditional database systems. That is very expensive. Their primary goal is not lose a single bit of the data, right? But for there, they want to be much more scalable, even though it might be okay to lose some of this data. So recently, these cloud-based distributed systems become very popular. So the examples are like Hadoop and other kinds of systems, Sparks. Those are at this different spectrum of data. We want to deploy a distributed systems at the cloud level so that we can have much higher scalability while it is not as important to actually keep the preserve the data as we did for the traditional systems. So in his big data systems class, Professor Conde talks about this recent development about this cloud-based data management. So those are the core information data management classes. And there are other kind of related classes as well. So if you want to develop your career in data systems engineering, these are other kind of very useful classes. You may want to take operating system classes because you have to learn about the systems. And you may also want to take classes on parallel and distributed computing and web applications, etc. If you want to develop your career in data scientist as a data scientist, of course, you have to know about linear algebra and applications, and you have to know about probability and statistics. And in CS170A, Professor Stott Parker also talks about the particular tools that are very useful for data science. So that is another class that you may want to take if you're interested in developing your career in data science. And recently, machine learning became a very important tool for analysis of the data. So this sequence of the classes related to machine learning can be also very useful if you want to be a data scientist eventually. Any questions? OK, thank you. Oh, yeah. Yes? 144, yeah. So the question is 143 prerequisite for 144? It is a prerequisite for 144, yes. Right, so you may be able to take the 144, but CS144 does assume that you know things from the CS143. So you may be able to take it. The dependency is not that big, but still, it does assume that you know the important topics there. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you. So the next field is networking. Unfortunately, professors in the networking field are all traveling today, so they are not available. So today, advanced senior PhD students will go over the classes that is being offered there.
Hi everyone, I'm Indy. I'm a PhD student from Lisha Zhang's group. And this is Josh from Professor Mario Girl's group. I guess our professor want to give you a different perspective about the courses, so they are out of time today. So Josh and I made a short summary about the courses in the networking area. So we'll first start from like the core knowledge you want to learn from those areas. So what you need to know about the networking is how does the internet works. So the internet is a huge distributed system involving a lot of components from the core network, the access network, the wireless network, the vehicle network, ad hoc network. So you may want to understand what's the working mechanism of all those systems, and what are the advantages of each system. So with this knowledge, you know what's the design purpose of each of them, what kind of problem they solve. And the next one is very important is what are the problems exist in those systems. Because we are doing some research, you always wish your research could solve some real problem, right? The last one is you may want to be aware of the ongoing research directions, because you don't want to submit a paper and then got some review comments saying that, oh, it's not a very interesting topic, because a lot of people have done enough research on it. So how can we get those knowledge or information? As system guys, the first approach is to play with the system, right? So you have to write some like applications or systems, especially related to networking, and so that you can discover all the stables in the details. And the second one is talk to people in those areas, so that you can discover all the problems. And so usually people go to the conference to talk to people from different areas. But if you don't have those opportunities, you may want to subscribe some mailing list, such as this NANOC, North American Network Operator Groups, and this IETF mailing list. There are a lot of working groups, research groups, and there's a lot of researchers, engineers. They post the questions, solutions, ideas onto this mailing list. So if you can spend a little bit of time in reading those mailing lists, it can help you to understand a lot of problems and solutions. And the last one, of course, is to take classes. So we will start from the undergrad course. It says 118. So this is kind of the first class about the networking, and it lays the foundation for all the other networking courses. So this one will give you an overview about the internet architecture. Like it will show you different layers of the protocols and how they interact with each other. And it will also give you a sense about how does those protocols works, right? From the application layer, such as the HTTP protocols, the DNS protocols, to the even the link layer or even physical layer. And so the networking courses emphasize the hands-on experience, so you need to do some projects. Here are at least two projects that you may need to take. The first one is like you probably want to build a simple router that can forward the IP packet. And the next one is to build a HTTP proxy or caching servers. Yeah. So for the graduate courses, we can classify them into three directions. So I will talk about the first direction, which is related to the networking architecture. And Josh will talk about the other two directions. So Professor Li Shizhang will give you two courses related to the networking architecture. The first, both of them focus on the design, the protocol design in those architecture. Right? The difference is that the first one, the 217A, focus on the existing architecture. And the second one, 217B, focus on the future internet work architecture. Right? So in the first one, Lisha will dive into the details of those protocols. So if you take the CS118, you learn how does those system works. And in 217A, you learn why the system is designed in this way. Right? So we will talk about the IP protocols, the DNS protocols, the routing protocols from the inter-domain routing, the intra-domain routing, and the different transport layer protocols. And why you want to take this course is, so Lisha is one of the few people who participate or witness the design process of the current internet architecture. So if you take the course, Lisha can share with you a lot of stories about why they design the protocol in this way and what are the requirements at that time and how the system evolved over the time. And she will also share with you about the principle of the design and what are the trade-offs people make to enable the system, and especially what are the lessons we learn from the practical operation, especially from the failures of the operation. For the next one, the 217B, so this one focuses on the future internet architecture. More specifically, it's about this named data networking, which is a multiple-year research project led by Lisha. So in this course, Lisha will let you go through the history of this project, like where did this idea come out, and how does it evolve, and what are the current status of the development and research. So this course emphasizes on the hands-on experience, so you need to do some projects to build your own system and application over NDN. And why you want to take this course is because the NDN is still in the stage of research and development. So in the process of building your own system and application in NDN, can help us to discover all the problems or some features in NDN. So in another word, you're also contributing to the new internet architecture. Yeah, so next I will give it to Josh.
Hello. All right. So there are two courses by Professor Songwei Lu. One is CS211 and one is Special Topics CS219. So the first one, CS211, this is a wireless and mobile networking. So for example, 4G, 5G, so like LTE. So how many people here use like LTE? Hopefully quite a few. And so like some recent research they have done, I think it's made the news, is in terms of like breaking these protocols. So for example, like how to get free data access, or conversely, how to attack other users and just make their bills go pretty high. So there's some very interesting research directions in LTE. Others would be like file systems, so like mobile file systems, maybe considering like consistency models. So like mobile networks, nodes maybe online or offline, and how to synchronize, and what are different trade-offs in these different architectures. There's also, like I mentioned, mobile services and security. And then CS219, so this is selected topics on cloud computing, focuses on network architecture. So for example, here's a data center fat tree topology. So in data centers, like I think some of the other classes mentioned, big data is very important. So the topology of the network architecture in a data center is very, very important because you want to get sub-millisecond speeds. So there'll be lots of interesting analysis and reviews of the current data center topologies and future research directions. Then also what's also important in terms of the database structure, the file system structure, and these distributed systems in the data center as well. And then Professor Jurla has two courses, CS218, which is currently right now the Advanced Computer Networks. The focus is on wireless, mobile networks, and applications. And then CS219 is current topics, so research directions in the mobile networks, peer-to-peer, ad hoc, and vehicle networks. So I think last week there was the talk about the Google car, about how it collects all sorts of sensor data. But this model assumes a hybrid, so it assumes that cars are both human drivers and autonomous vehicles. But we can also think of if everything's like autonomous vehicles, there'll be some sort of need for vehicle-to-vehicle communication, so some sort of peer-to-peer ad hoc. Some other examples are peer-to-peer or Napster and Skype. So this class will kind of focus on these type of topologies. And then courses that are useful, there's two in EE, so Professor Mani Srivastava. There's M202A, which is embedded systems, modeling, specification, energy usage. And then Professor Rubin has various courses for network communication. I think there's like five different courses, and there's different modeling, so discrete stochastic processes, queuing theory, and some sort of graphs and network flows. So that should be it if there's any questions.
Thank you. So the last speaker is on the theory field, Professor Yuval Ishak. He will give a presentation.
Hi, everyone. I'm the only non-local person. I come from the Technion in Israel, and I'm doing my sabbatical here at UCLA. I'm a theoretical computer scientist, so I'm allowed not to use PowerPoint and just talk. And I represent five faculty members who are mostly traveling, so if you like traveling and you don't like PowerPoint, then you should seriously consider theoretical computer science. Okay, so what do we do in theoretical computer science? Well, basically we take a real-life problem that we want to solve using computers. We distill its essence and formulate a clean mathematical problem that captures it. And once we have this clean and rigorous formulation, we can ask all kinds of questions about it and try to answer them. And I think that this research in this field has three characteristics that distinguish it from most other research in computer science. One is that it is very high level. It allows us to ask what we can do in principle using computers, regardless of today's technology. So what is it possible in principle to solve efficiently? So we use asymptotics like polynomial time to make the questions cleaner and also to make the conclusions applicable not only to today's technology but also to the future and also to future technologies such as quantum computing, for instance. The second point is that once we have a clean, rigorous mathematical formulation of the problems, we can prove theorems. And also, the third thing is that it also allows us to prove negative results. So to show that certain things cannot be done, which is something that really, if you're working in an applied area, you're working, you're thinking hard of your favorite problem and you cannot solve it, it's typically very hard to gain any evidence that what you're trying to do is impossible. And theoretical computer science has the privilege of being sometimes able to prove either unconditional negative results or negative results of the form that if you give me a solution to this problem, it would imply a solution to a long-standing mathematical question that many, many, many super clever people spend time on. So that's a benefit we get from being able to get a rigorous formulation of the problem. Okay, so now I'll briefly describe some courses in this area. There are five faculty members, and I will go from the youngest to the most senior. So the youngest, I guess, is Raghu Mehta. He's a pretty fresh faculty member here, and he's giving two classes. The first is called Pseudorandomness and Explicit Constructions. The basic question can be thought of as finding, it sounds a bit funny, but finding a hay in a haystack, right? So you have think of a typical question in this area. You have some object that is very easy to construct by tossing coins. Say a graph that has many edges, but does not have a small cycle, right? So you can prove that such a graph exists. And almost any, you know, you let a kid draw a random graph, it will almost certainly satisfy this property, but somehow the question of finding an explicit construction of such a graph is elusive. Similarly, I guess that the core question in this course is how to reduce the amount of randomness. If you have a randomized algorithm that tosses many coins, can you come up with a similar algorithm that tosses fewer coins or even no coins that is totally deterministic? So it turns out that this is really like finding a hay in a haystack. It sounds paradoxically easy, but this question turned out to be notoriously difficult and also related to many other questions in different areas of computer science. So that's the pseudo-randomness and the explicit constructions class. Raghu is also teaching a class that is related to some of the things we heard from Adnan. He's also teaching a theoretical algorithmic learning theory class, which covers certain mostly recent techniques in learning theory, such as multiplicative weights method for those that heard that have a lot of impact in the field on the field recently. Moving to the next faculty member, Sasha Sherstov. He's also working in complexity theory. He teaches an introductory class to theoretical computer science called Computability and Complexity. This is where you learn in more depth about notions such as NP-completeness and also about the resources required in principle to solve different computational tasks. And these resources include not only time, but also things like space and amount of randomness. Space meaning memory and randomness. So questions like, can I solve this algorithmic problem using a logarithmic amount of space in the input length, or by using only a small amount of randomness or no randomness? This is the type of questions that are covered in this class. The main research area of Professor Sherstov is communication complexity. Communication complexity is also Communication complexity is also a very big and active area in theoretical computer science. It talks about problems that are distributed, where the inputs are divided between two or more parties, and the question is how many bits do the parties need to communicate in order to compute the function. So none of them can compute it on its own, right? And the question is how many bits do we need to communicate, say, to check whether two big databases are equal. Or in case, you know, they differ from each other, you know, how many bits do we need to synchronize them or to find where the differences are? This is the type of questions that are dealt with in the area of communication complexity. Okay, we have two faculty members that work in the field of cryptography, Amit Sahai and Rafi Ostrovsky, and they teach courses in this area. Cryptography is a really beautiful area. It kind of exploits the dark side of algorithms, right? So if you have problems that you cannot, that you believe that are hard on average, right, even for random input, these problems can be useful for cryptography. Cryptography is traditionally about secret communication, but nowadays it deals a lot with questions about securing computations in various ways, obfuscating computations, securing computing on our secret data without revealing it to each other. This is the type of problems that are dealt with in these cryptography classes. Just to give you a couple of examples to illustrate the flavor of these problems, for instance, you know, if I want to communicate with someone I never met before, right? I pick someone whom I never met before, you, and I want to communicate to you a secret message. You know, we have no prior agreement on some secret key, and I can talk to her, she can talk to me. In the end of this conversation, you know, after some short exchange of messages, we both know, so I communicated to her my secret, and nobody else in the audience, even though you heard every word that came out of my mouth and every word that came out of her mouth, under, you know, widely believed mathematical conjectures, nobody else can figure out what this secret was, right? It sounds amazing, but this is the type of things that are done in cryptography, and I can go on and on and give many such examples of things that look completely paradoxical and yet can be solved under reasonable assumptions. Finally, we have Professor Gaffney. He's the most senior. He teaches classes on algorithms and also distributed algorithms. Distributed algorithms, just to give you again a sample problem in the area, suppose that we can only communicate via emails, so one-to-one, right? I can send an email to each one of you, and you want to be convinced that you all received the same message, right? You don't trust me, so I can, you know, send, this stock will go up to this part of the room, and this stock will go down to the other part. And you want to be convinced that whatever you receive from me is the same. Now, a simple solution is, you know, you just compare notes and check that, you know, and check that you got the same message from me. But now, if you compare notes and you figure that the things do not look the same, how do you know that I was lying? Maybe the guy that was talking to you was lying, right? So distributed algorithms is all about, you know, this he says, she says type of problems where we need to converge to agreement or to solve some distributed task without knowing who are the bad guys and who are the good guys. Okay, so that's it, and I hope you take classes in this area.
Okay, thank you very much, everyone. I hope the presentations were helpful to prepare for your proposal of the fields, etc. Okay, good night.